I'm so delighted to have Katherine Zoepf here tonight. She's going to be discussing her new and very first book. It's called Excellent Daughters, The Secret Lives of Young Women Who Are Transforming the Arab World. I think some of you probably know this, but for those who don't, she came to her subject as a journalist. She'd been based in Syria, Lebanon, and later Iraq. She traveled the whole region for more than a decade. And I would say her reportorial approach appears to have been very simple and straightforward, full immersion. She spent lots of time working her way behind the scenes where she could observe, interview, and learn from all sorts of Arab women in all sorts of places, and most often women living lives very different from her own. Now, I think it's probably fair to say that most of us who are acculturated in the West have notions about what it means to be a woman in the Arab world. We have all read stories about violence and other abuses and atrocities committed against women in different countries, Malala being just one of the most celebrated examples. We also have read about the lack of rights accorded to women in many parts of the Arab world. And we, and I do include myself here, have often arrived at conclusions about Arab women based on fragments of information and our own Western assumptions and projections. And so what I really would like to say is so wonderful, at least to me, about this book, and what makes it both so fascinating and so important is that Katherine has so effectively resisted lapsing into the easy and convenient stereotypes. She does not settle for bold proclamation, but rather she probes for nuance, for a deeper understanding that allows for more accurate, more sensitive, and more complete portraits of women across the region. Some of you have undoubtedly already read her reporting and writing from her pieces in the New York Times, the New Yorker, and the New York Observer. And I should mention that she also has been a fellow at the New America Foundation. She certainly has made the most of all of these experiences, and as a result has given us a fresh, thoughtful, and superbly done book about a timely and significant topic. I hope you all will read it. I'm sure you will gain a lot if you do. Please join me in welcoming Katherine Zoepf to Politics and Prose. That's better. There we go. So, Katherine, first of all, congratulations.
Thank you. What a terrific...
I was saying to her earlier that writing any book, frankly, if you just finish it and have it done, is an amazing accomplishment. I've lived with someone who did, too, and I think, you know, we all pleaded with him never to do it again. But in any case, it's such an accomplishment to do a book that required such intensive reporting in such a difficult part of the world, and then to complete the writing of it is really tremendous, and you really deserve a lot of congratulations. But I did want to ask you, how did you get into this subject in the first place?
Well, the book, you can all hear me, right? As I describe a little bit in the first chapter of the book, I hadn't really intended to report on the Arab world. It hadn't even been particularly a region that I was, you know, even especially compelled by. But then, right after I got out of college, I got a job. It was sort of my first, real job as an assistant at the New York Times. And I was an assistant to one of the columnists, or then columnist Bill Keller, who of course later became the executive editor. And September 11th was my second day of work. And suddenly, sort of everything that I think it was partly my age, but it was like to be in New York, to have just moved to New York, and to really not know very many people there, and to have just started this new job, where suddenly all of the writers that I most admired were really focusing on reporting on this region. I became really fascinated, and I had always I'd studied literature in college. I took an Italian class on Dante my sophomore year with this very charismatic professor, and I majored in Italian and French literature, and I wanted to be a complete scholar. I think what I would have told you if you'd interviewed me as a senior in college, and you know, I had, you know, I enjoyed writing, but I didn't really, and suddenly I felt like, you know, maybe this had been a waste of time. I knew nothing about the world. I wished I'd studied almost, you know, history or, you know, or political science, or just, you know, nothing made sense anymore. And I started reading a lot of Arabic, Arabic literature and translation, and just started reading a lot, and started to you know, I just wanted to go. And I think I should also mention actually one of my classmates, a girl who had, you know, had sort of been in my rooming group, had died on September 11th, and I just, you know, became 19 of the, was it 19? Somebody, Bobby, you probably know this. 19 of the hijackers were Saudis. Was it 15? I'm sorry, 15. I have it in my book correctly. I think I became particularly interested in Saudi Arabia and in the Gulf countries and in the version of Islam that was it was taught in schools there and how it was understood I sort of couldn't look away from the Arab world, and I traveled there as soon as I got the chance, which was a couple of years later.
So what you're saying is that your parents thought you were going to be a compilate scholar nice ivory tower, and instead you packed your bags and moved to...
Yeah, they still haven't...
They must have been thrilled. No.
Yeah, they still haven't quite gotten over it, it was a huge surprise, I think, to everybody, you know, everybody who knew me in college, that I would do this, and a huge surprise to me, actually, and I think it was only in sort of very small steps. Like, I couldn't, you know, I mean, maybe for any, you know, anyone in your 20s, it's hard to imagine kind of that you'll be doing something for, you know, 2 years, let alone a decade. You know, it just feels like, oh my gosh, it's such an I initially went to Syria because the then new foreign editor at the Times knew of my interest and sort of basically offered to pay for a plane ticket in exchange for and some Arabic lessons were sort of thrown in exchange for 6 months as stringing and which when you're 25 just seems like a fantastic deal. You know, I think my parents were like, well, you know what, you know, no medical insurance, you know what, no guarantee that they'll even publish any of your work. But anyway, I did it, and I thought, you know, okay, I can definitely commit to 6 months, and then, you know, ended up staying a lot longer.
Well, and you did have to learn Arabic, so that was a huge obstacle.
Okay, no? So I want to be careful. I mean, I studied Arabic for a long time. I think it's a, you know, as anyone probably, you know, I know some of you in the audience have studied it. It's a really difficult language, and there are different dialects, I am not able to sort of do a really good interview in Arabic still. You know, I can chit chat and I can understand a fair amount, but I want to be really careful about, you know, I'm not a fluent Arabic speaker, but I think my, you know, studying it has, you know, certainly helped a lot, and to the degree that I do speak, I think it's, yeah, I mean, I think, you know, having studied foreign languages really intensely in college, I always feel very sort of, cautious about making claims about my Arabic, because it's so much more difficult than French or Italian. I think I was used to thinking of myself as somebody who was like good at languages, and all of that was, you know, sort of thrown away.
Very much tested with Arabic.
No, I mean, I still sort of read like a first grader with my finger under the words. Anyway, I hope.
Yeah, no, and so you headed off to Syria. Obviously, fortunately, different when you landed there than it is today.
Yes.
Were you nervous? Were you, I mean, was this an act of naivete or bravery?
I mean, I don't know that it was either, really. I think at the time, Syria was really a kind of a backwater. It was very sleepy, very, I mean, as a young freelancer, it had the amazing advantage of, you know, of being a place where it was really difficult to get a press visa. And so there was always this sort of sweet spot, you know, where something would happen and, you know, the New York Times would sort of like want you to do a few stories before they could get like the real journalists to come in from Cairo. And so I think you know, for a while, but it was sort of, it wasn't a place, it was also not a place that anybody who could afford to live elsewhere would actually really want to live, you know? But it was a place where, you know, you could rent an apartment for, a pretty nice apartment for $400 a month. And you know, if it was a slow month, you know, it was, I'm speaking a lot about the practicalities of working as a young journalist, but, you know, as more and more, you know, newspapers are, you know, are closing, newspapers and magazines are closing their foreign bureaus. I think that a lot more of our reporting is coming from people who were, you know, young people who were doing what I did, you know, a decade ago.
But then you shifted, I mean, you became interested in really a very specific aspect of life in these countries, and that was the life and lives of women. And yeah. What was that? How did that evolution take place?
I mean, I think it was partly, I think that it was, you know, I was in my mid-20s and, you know, young women were, young Arab women were kind of my friends, and they were the people I talked to the most. But it was also because you know, reporting there, in the Arab world, reporting on, you know, crises of various kinds are sort of what naturally dominate the headlines, and you know, reporting on on terrorism and political upheavals of various kinds is it's certainly very, very, very important. But then I think that can have a sort of distorting effect on our overall view of the region. And you know, I came more and more to see a real sort of disconnect between the way the region was perceived and the way it was and the reality of you know, the lives of ordinary people. And I was I started to look for ways to sort of tell more of those stories. And I think that when you're looking at these bigger stories, that sort of dominate the headlines, you know, it can be very hard to sort of see social change. I mean, social change is obviously a much slower process, and I think that life can look very static when it's set against these bigger events. But I saw a lot of change happening, and people talked to me about a lot of change, and so I wanted to try to report on change as it was being felt, and that meant, actually, I mean, maybe my earlier background was in literature helped a little, because I did sort of feel like there's something that, you know, sort of fiction teaches us, you know, about, you know, the importance of these small gestures that can then, and I started to wonder whether there was a case to be made for reporting on these small gestures and how, you know, these tiny decisions, you know, in an individual life that in aggregate in many people's lives, you know, daughters making very, very slightly different decisions than the ones their mothers made can actually add up to something interesting. And
we tend to be, I mean, I think one of the points of your book that I found really interesting is that kind of what we would view as incrementalism, mm-hmm. and almost judgmentally,
yeah,
actually is much more profound in places where, you know, we just have a very different way of measuring.
I, I think it is, yeah. I mean, I think it's very much so. I mean, I was most, so my most recent trip to the region was to Saudi Arabia 2 months ago. I was reporting a New Yorker piece on the first Saudi women, you know, to become practice as lawyers, and they've only been allowed to practice as lawyers for 2 years, and in a country of 27 million, there are now 67 women who have qualified as lawyers, and they're all very young. The oldest female lawyer I interviewed was 30, and you know, it's pretty difficult to see, like, you know, what effect they might be having, but then you start to hear, basically I found that the mere existence of these women lawyers, even though the lawyers themselves are in many cases like still struggling to find jobs because there are very few Saudi law firms that are set up in such a way that they have a whole women's section so that the women can work, according to the standards that have been set by the labor ministry, but the mere existence of women in law schools and women as lawyers is causing a lot of ordinary Saudi women to sort of realize that they actually have rights under Saudi law, and this has come as a revelation to many of them, and it seems. Honestly, like I had never reported on the law before, and it was very difficult because you come up against laws that are so specific in, you know, the a woman's word, a woman's testimony in court is worth half that of a man, and like the precision of that it takes two women to equal one man. I just found very, like, just an outrage, really, and so, the idea of, you know, that these female lawyers were accepting that system and saying, well, we have to work within that, you know, was something I really struggled with. But then, you know, you come to see that actually they're starting from a place that's several steps behind even that. You know, that many, many judges, in fact, do not accept any woman's word in court, even though the law says you can bring in two women. There are many judges who still resist that. And they have the right to resist it in the Saudi system. You meet women that didn't realize until they happened to meet a Saudi law student that they had the right, for example, to ask to see their children, you know, who they had lost in the divorce, or that some women can get custody of their children in court. And so these things are really important to them, and I wanted to try to argue for like not missing those things in our sort of and I share the sense that, like, you know, with this whole system, like, how can you work with this, but you know, perhaps But the lawyers I spoke to would say that it's more practical to insist, you know, to get all of our rights within this system, and I couldn't get any of them to actually say, and then we'll see. But mm-hmm. But I felt that there was, you know, in some of those conversations there was an implied, you know, and then the next step. So anyway,
so you were based in Syria, and then you also lived in Lebanon, and you lived in Baghdad most recently.
Yes.
And so that's a pretty good mix, I guess. And is there one thing in particular that you, looking back on your time there, surprised you most about the region, the women, what you expected, what you came upon?
I think that this idea appears in several parts of the book because it's something that I saw again and again, and that always, you know, for some reason came as a surprise. It's something that seems like it's a move in the other direction can actually serve very progressive goals. You know, I met a number of women in Syria who are in pre-Civil War Syria. There were basically Islamic schools for girls had became very, very popular. And they were very, very conservative, and they were encouraging women to cover completely. But they were encouraging women to memorize the Quran and to really know it. And the women themselves would say, you know, they were not, you know, progressives in a way that we would understand, but they would say, you know, when I really know the Quran and I know it, you know, better than my father or my husband, I gain a sort of status in my family, and then once you have that, then maybe, you know, or my family, you know, because I've become so devout and so, precise and punctilious about my religious observance, my family will now trust me and allow me to go to university, and they wouldn't have otherwise. And so, I think that there can be these surprising, ways in which something that might not seem like it is, embracing of greater freedom or greater role in the world might actually allow women to achieve, be a more practical way maybe for these women to achieve their goals.
You did encounter women who were pretty seriously depressed.
I did. Too. Yeah.
And they, I was sort of surprised that they were willing to share that, or was.
I think you're probably speaking about the Saudi chapter. I did some reporting, and it was first appeared in the New Yorker, there's an expanded sort of version of the section in the book, about women who were taking jobs as shopkeepers, who were working in. And again, this is like a conservative argument that ended up meeting progressive ends. It was basically, the argument was made like, it is shameful for a woman to have to buy lingerie from a man, and we need to put women to work, which is, you know, in the public space, in malls, which is very shocking, still for many Saudis, and very controversial, in order to protect women from this horrible violation of having to, you know, to ask for like the correct, you know, bra size or whatever from a male sales clerk. And but this ended up, you know, so there was a campaign for this, and King Abdullah, who was actually probably the most progressive King Saudi Arabia's ever had for on women's issues, at least, and certainly looks like kind of like Dr. Martin Luther King compared to his successor, frankly. The law was changed. Women were put to work in lingerie stores, makeup shops, and there were certain other kinds of abaya shops. There are a couple of other, but women, you know, shops that cater to you know, sort of a predominantly, if not exclusively, female clientele, and this was the first time that jobs had been available to uneducated Saudi women. I mean, for a generation or so, it's been possible to go to Saudi Arabia and you meet, you know, surgeons and university professors. But I mean, these are really very elite women, and they represent a very small percentage of the population. But now you're having women who basically hadn't had any life at all outside the home, who after finishing high school or who after marrying in middle school and then raising children, you know, were at home. Because the women I was interviewing were really the first to go to work, they tended to be women who were outcasts. I don't want to say outcasts. It sounds, feel like that's, it does them an injustice, but they were divorcees, they were women widows, they were women who, for some reason or other, had some really difficult family situation, which meant that they didn't have a family saying, you know, preventing them from doing this. And they were women who really had to find some way of improving their economic situation. And so these were women who had very difficult circumstances, and they were you know, I met so many women who had never met another divorced woman before they went to work in a shop a few months before, and suddenly they were having conversations and they were realizing, well, wait a minute, I'm learning that it's actually, I can ask, you know, my children's father to be allowed to see them, and I haven't seen them in 7 years, and these things were, I don't know, and I felt like they were, you know, I don't want to go all Marxist, but I felt like there was this sort of like, you know, kind of fledgling sense of class consciousness of among these women, and there was a lot of camaraderie, and they loved it, and they loved sort of having, you know, friends to kind of share their lunches with during breaks. I mean, it was very sad, but it was really it was kind of amazing to see how, you know, how much this sort of very small change in the law that was really, I mean, and the women that it put to work were, you know, it wasn't a huge proportion of them, but it was meaningful, and I think that they're, you know, Saudi society in general, 2 years later, they're a little bit more used to seeing women in the public space. Mm-hmm. So
progress of some sort. Yeah. I just want to ask one more question, but I do think we should open it up to all of you. So if you have a question and could start making your way to a microphone, that would be great. But let me just ask you, before we take an audience question, do you have, seeing what's going on now throughout the region, mm-hmm. And obviously tensions escalating in all sorts of ways, which mm-hmm. would have repercussions for everyone, not only women, can you possibly forecast the future? Are you optimistic?
It's really difficult. I always sort of shy away from, I mean, they're completely natural questions to ask, and I would be asking them, but I find them very tricky because but if you're looking specifically at women, and you know, you're looking at this, you know, the social change, you're looking at the, you know, I think that you know, women are going to university in kind of greater numbers than men all over the region, and especially in the Gulf countries, the proportions are, you know, the proportions of women are even greater compared to the men, and the women will tell you, well, this is partly because like it's a socially acceptable way to delay marriage, or to be outside the home in a way that their families will support. I think that is very important. I also think I think social media is also, you know, I think it can be overstated, but it has been, you know, in countries where the press is very, very heavily state controlled, it can be very hard to be, and also, you know, you don't have any freedom of association, really. You know, it can be very hard to meet like-minded people or people who share your struggles, and I think social media has helped that, and you know, as we saw in the Arab Spring, it's already. I think its impact can be overstated, but I think it's really important. I don't want to make a big pronouncement, but I think I'm overall optimistic, I would say.
I mean, you describe women who are living in their homes, and really their only connection to the outside world is through the internet and social media.
Yeah, and that unfortunately remains true, but I think it's I think it is starting to shift. You know, even the most conservative.
So we can be somewhat hopeful. I'm sure some of you extremely wonderful, smart, intelligent people have questions. Aha! Here we go. First question. And also, Katherine, if you want to chime in on anything else, you should feel free to.
Thank you.
Well, I assume, but I could be wrong, that Saudi Arabia is sort of the least enlightened of the countries you've lived in terms of women. But could you give us some idea of the comparisons among these countries, which were the more liberal, et cetera?
I mean, I hope I haven't sounded like I'm focusing too much on Saudi Arabia. I mean, it was where I was most recently, and I think in some ways it, because it's so, its interpretations of Islam is so extreme, it's, you know, it sometimes ends up being the focus. But even Saudi Arabia, it's a very diverse country. Are you asking?
Well,
sort of
I would assume, for instance, but I could be wrong, that Lebanon would be a little more free for women, possibly Iraq because of all the things we've done there.
It always depends, you know, on which. You know, which group of women you're talking about, which community, and which part of the country. So it's hard to generalize even about Lebanon. I mean, you go to Beirut and you see, you know, women, wearing things that I would be embarrassed to wear in public, or living. But there are also a lot of communities there where the lives are much more similar to. The lives of the Saudi women, you know, we've been discussing, than they are to ours. In general, I think the Ba'athist country, Syria and Iraq, this is something that's been sort of an unfortunate, thing, but I think that, you know, in Syria and Iraq, Ba'athism is a very, very secular ideology, not nationalist ideology, and girls were forbidden from wearing the hijab in schools. Were encouraged to get job, you know, to work in government. And I do think there's been a little bit of a backlash in Iraq, and we've seen this also under, you know, in Mubarak really pressed hard for. And his wife Suzanne Mubarak, especially was known for promoting for women's rights, and there's definitely been a backlash against that. There's a lot of talk in Egypt a couple of years ago about Suzanne's laws, and it was not a positive descriptor, and it was basically these laws like. Better rights for women in divorces and in inheritance, mostly aspects of family law, and there was a lot of pushback, I think, initially. It's always tricky to talk about the mood, but yes.
I'm also curious about. How you got to know these women, initially the ones in Syria. I had great problems in France as an au pair girl meeting French women. And so I'd like to know a little more about.
Well, I mean, I think, so I think having, I mean, I mean, I'm pretty shy, and I never really thought I could be a news reporter. But the great thing about, you know, reporting and having these assignments is that you're sort of forced to, and then you sort of, you develop, you now have these people that you know, and that you know, have told you about their lives, you know, often for a news story, and I would end up going back to them again and again, or they would have, you know, comments on what they thought I'd gotten, you know, I'd been sort of off base about, you know, in the story. Another sort of amazing thing about social media and the internet is that suddenly, you know, your subjects are reading your work in real time, translated into Arabic by one of these pan-Arab dailies. And so you're getting phone calls like, wait a second, I also said this, but you only quoted that one thing, I found that horrifying because I would always feel, you know, sort of cringing, and before I called the person back and you know, worrying, okay, gosh, did I really get something terribly wrong? But usually it was something. Thank goodness it usually wasn't, you know, as something that, you know, that was a mistake, but it was something where they felt like there was a nuance that had been lost. And I thought those conversations, you know, after publishing a sort of rough draft, not a rough draft because it appeared in the, you know, newspaper, but I found those conversations really interesting, and I think a lot of that has sort of found its way into the book. But you know, over time, I don't know, and I think, I mean, yeah, I'm sorry. I think that's probably, I don't want to ramble on, but.
Hi.
Hi.
I'd like to ask you about how you, as a conspicuously American woman, a young woman, were able to move around in these countries and function as a journalist, not only in your focus on women's personal life, but you filed a lot of stories to the New York Times on various topics. Mm-hmm. Now, the New York Times obviously has a certain amount of cachet, and you had press credentials. But I'm remembering from about 20 years ago, I had a woman friend who was an engineer, about 30, and she worked for an American company. Mm-hmm. And they had offices in various places, including Alexandria, Egypt. Mm-hmm. And she went there, and she had problems moving in the streets on her way to work. 12 and 13-year-old boys would follow and throw rocks at her and call her a whore.
That sort of thing does exist, depending on where you are. I was lucky not to experience all that much of it. But I came to feel that, on balance, it's a little easier to report as a woman. I think you're less conspicuous, you're less threatening, you're able to, maybe on the margins, there can be harassment, or it can be more difficult, especially with sort of very high level officials, to get anybody to really want, they want to hear they don't really take you seriously, and so they don't want to meet you. But there are struggles, but I think on balance you get a broader picture of the society, just because both men and women will talk to you, and you'll be invited into homes where a conservative man would not allow another man, even from his own culture, perhaps even his own brother, to meet his wife. But you can talk to everyone together, and I think that's a huge advantage. And also, people just invite you more immediately. I think on balance, I found it more a help, at least for the kinds of stories I wanted to do.
At least for the kind of stories that you wanted to do. Was it a problem for what we would call hard news, or great events news, or?
Maybe. It's hard to say. I mean, there are certainly many great female journalists who have done wonderful reporting of that kind in the region. So I don't want to say that it's a bar. I found that kind of reporting possibly a little harder. But I ended up feeling that the greater access to a kind of broader swath of the population ended up being more valuable and more interesting, honestly, to me.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think everybody here would like to ask you what your daily life was like living there, but I guess we'll read your book.
Thank you.
Do you have any other questions? I just have another one or two in case somebody decides they do have a question. I asked you what the biggest surprise was. What was the biggest challenge? What was the hardest moment for you?
Oh, goodness. I mean, personally or in terms of confronting something as a reporter
I found really personally upsetting. Living in a...
Oh, gosh. That's really hard to say. Maybe the hardest thing personally was sort of living in Syria, pre-Civil War Syria. The the sort of subtle ways in which the kind of the paranoia about the security services who were sort of everywhere and kind of always tapping your phone, it kind of would get under your skin, and how people's anxieties I ended up finding it something that was, you'd end up sort of questioning, you know, before you went out to report something, like, okay, well, who would be, you know, I don't know, who would that offend, or would that be too dangerous for the person that I am speaking to? And I found that really tricky to navigate. And having not grown up there, I didn't have as instinctive a sense of what was a red line and what wasn't. And I think initially, I think you come in as a foreigner and you feel like, having an American passport gives you a certain amount of protection. But even then, I found it. And, you know, and the religious police in Saudi Arabia, have had some really sort of nasty encounters with them, and sort of how very, you know, intimidating it is, and sort of without a, and that I feel that even as a, you know, even as a foreigner who can basically leave any time, made me sort of have so much respect for people who are doing kind of these amazing things, while, being basically stuck in that. In that context,
yeah.
So.
No, it's interesting. We do have another question.
Hi, I just wanted to hear your opinion about.
Can you speak into the mic?
Okay, just wanted to hear your opinion about on this, that these factors that limited women's rights or women's lives in these countries, do you think they are mostly from like the religion or the culture or the politics in the area? Because these countries that you have been, the Arab-speaking countries, are similar, but they're not the same, like, especially religion-wise. Like,
yeah,
Lebanon and Syria are more, like, they're not 100% Islamic.
Well, so. the answer, the women, I mean, the women, 201, and mm-hmm. anyone that wants to sort of touch on anything that might be critical, will always say the culture. It's definitely not the religion. And that's in part because, you know, in Islam, you can't criticize it, or you risk, you know, being seen as a heretic, and the fact that that's a capital offense, that questioning it, and you know, questioning religion is a capital offense in so many of these countries, has a really means that it's very difficult to talk about reforming the religion itself, and I mean, not everywhere in the region, but in most places that I reported, and even when it's not officially a capital offense, it's something that's very, very difficult for people. So, culture is the official answer. I think that it's probably a little more complicated. I think that there are, you know, ways in which religion is interpreted that are really, you know, until they can be reinterpreted in some way, are really going to put definite limits on women's progress. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, thank you, because I'm, like, based on my knowledge, I would know some of the families that were not as conservative, but still they wouldn't allow their women to do much outside because of the culture or because mm-hmm. of the safety. Mm-hmm. So that's what I wanted to know, okay. Your opinion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any parting thoughts, and maybe a one suggestion or one thing that all presidential candidates should be thinking about in regards to this region?
Oh, my goodness.
I think they all need some advice.
Oh, my goodness.
Or at least most of them.
Presidential candidates. Gosh. This is definitely above my pay grade. I mean, I would... I would urge a little... I sometimes worry that there's too much focus on activists, and of course it's very exciting to talk to people who are saying these brave things, but it can be very difficult to find out where they really stand in relation to their societies, and often they're almost I've met people who were, you know, among the most widely quoted activists in their countries, and this is true across the region, who were basically essentially unknown. At home, and I just would urge, like, closer attention to the conversations that are being had, on the editorial pages and in the, the social media on the social media platforms. I think that there can be a. It's very exciting to talk, to talk about revolution and all this potential, but it can be a little bit misleading. So,
are you ladies wanting to ask questions? Okay, last two questions. Thank you. Great that you came up. Go ahead. Two more questions, and then we're going to unfortunately have to end it there. But you've got the floor.
Great, thank you.
I
would be curious to hear your opinion on women's rights in light of the Arab Spring. It seems like the media kind of framed things more in the political than the personal, so mm-hmm. that may have been an overlooked point. And I'm thinking specifically of the situation in Egypt, where mm-hmm. women were all of a sudden mobilized to protest mm-hmm. and really involved in all that stuff. But at the same time, they seemed, both female journalists and female Egyptians, seemed to suffer a great degree of victimization in that as yeah. well. So I'd be curious to hear your views.
It's very tricky. I mean, I've met so many women who've sort of felt that as the moment where they felt that their voices were first heard. But then there's just, as you said, there's been this incredible, backlash, and that's had, that's still being felt, I think. I would say most of the women that I, that I stay in touch with, feel that in general, like that there's a sort of a silence that's been, a barrier that's been broken, and, that ultimately that's something they have a lot of hope in. So, but it's a really complicated, the effects are really complicated. So,
last question.
So I read your really interesting recent piece in The New Yorker about Saudi Arabian women. I haven't read the chapter in the book, so you may talk about this, but was interested in the fact that there is this concern about Saudi women knowing their rights, mm-hmm. let alone, and the difficulties of actually reforming the system. But I was wondering whether any of these women, whether the lawyers or law students, were also in dialogue with you about the plight of non-Arab women, non-Saudi women, all the yeah. women in the Gulf who are clearly exploited. Yeah. Now, did they feel any kind of solidarity, or is it, there's clearly hierarchy?
This is something that I've sort of struggled with in reporting on Saudi women's progress, because I think it's often sort of it's enabled by the labor of millions and millions of women from developing countries. I remember talking to an activist who really impressed me and struck me as like really brave and fantastic. And then in a later conversation, I can't even remember how it came up, but she was talking about her struggles with her maid, and this maid was just so stupid. And of course she had to beat her sometimes because this was the only thing that these people understood. I don't mean to suggest that all Saudis hold these. I mean, I certainly met Saudis who were really concerned about. But it was something I struggled with. And it's something that I don't think I haven't really reported on it directly. And I should. I'd like to in the future, because I think it's something that is very difficult to talk about. And actually something that came up with the Saudi lawyers, because there are crimes that women are sort of disproportionately accused of, and one of them is sorcery. When I would ask the lawyers about these people, but it's not Saudi women who are being accused of sorcery, and because it's the Ethiopian maid, and the family will notice some object in her room from her country, and they'll decide, oh, that's an object of witchcraft, and then suddenly she's facing trial for sorcery, and there's been a sort of resurgent interest in sorcery. Actually, there's a new special unit of the secret police, which is devoted to sorcery investigations, and there are these sorcery hotlines where you can anonymously report somebody that you suspect of sorcery and have them investigated, and these things it's taken very seriously. And talking to lawyers who discuss this with a straight face was difficult. And the fact that they didn't think of it was a concern because it was not Saudi women who were you know, who were suffering the effects of it was, you know, was something I'd like to kind of look at actually, you know, at some point. So thank you.
So she will be back for her next book, clearly. So thank you so much, Katherine. Thank you all for coming out and really appreciate it. And if you have not gotten a copy.